And to get to his front door, you had to go up, like, basically up a set of steps and cut back around to another set of steps. And then you're out on a balcony, basically, to get in his front door. Yeah. And dragging his fucking TV out and then trying to lower it down into the bed of my truck was a pain in the ass. Oh, my God. Dude, no. Like, we had it hooked up with fucking ropes, pulleys, and a fucking set of 2x4s.
Yeah, that's like having a pickup. Everybody needs you to help move shit. Yeah, you damn right, man. It's crazy. Oh,
well, shit. He moved. It took when he moved. I had an old 94 F-150, and I mean it had a full bed on it and all that. And it took probably 3 loads in my truck, and then my brother had a little Mazda B4000. We took 3 loads in my truck and like 4 loads in his. And it was like we got, you know, a majority of the shit out, but there was just, oh God, it was a fucking pain.
Hell yeah. I mean, it's always a pain. It's always a pain.
I honestly was like, you know what? People are constantly asking me to move them. I might as well go buy a U-Haul. Not rent it, but buy it. That way, you know, they say, oh, can you move me? Yeah, I'm a fucking U-Haul service. You know, you pay me, I'll fucking move your ass.
Hell yeah. Damn right. So, you know, we just kind of scrolling through the news a little bit. BBC had to put out today that, you know, this kind of nonchalant, but it's been 20 years since J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone first cast its spell on readers across the globe. And they actually got a picture of what Harry Potter's supposed to look like. And he's a little dinky. He is a little dinky. So, yeah. Let's see. You know, everybody knows that Kalina fucking filed for its independence last week. Barcelona had her damn rally. So I feel forgotten by Catalina government. You know, Catalina's in Spain, right there near Barcelona. You know, it's, I have to say, man, I'm kind of stoked, kind of proud to see these other countries, you know, declaring their independence, man, and being able to do their own thing and live their own way and all that stuff and whatnot. Because it's, you know, I think everybody should have their independence and be able to live the way they want to live and do and have their government the way that they want it. Of course, there's always gotta be somebody that's going to say something about it. But you know what? If you don't like it, declare your independence and do what you do. ISIS last stand in Syria. The crisis.
Seen that?
Yeah. So what's that fucking mean?
They're losing footing quick.
That's a good thing. That's a good thing. So let's play this little bit right here and see what BBC's got to say about this.
As the Islamic State group makes their last stand in Syria, this is the humanitarian crisis that follows. These people are just some of the 350,000 who have been forced to flee their homes in Deir ez-Zor province since this offensive started. After living under the militants' rule for years, they are now viewed with suspicion.
It is urgent. Please, we need a solution for this situation. It's a very bad situation.
Many end up here in the desert, waiting for days before they are given permission to travel to camps.
We escaped. We left everything. Our building, some family is still there. We left everything, no money with us. And we came here, no shelter, no food, no water, no everything.
If people stay here for 2 more days, they will all die. We would rather be killed in an airstrike or IS than come here. My daughter is suffering from a bowel sickness. She is ill. I used to take her to Damascus for treatment. Since IS took over, they wouldn't even allow us to leave the village.
Closer to the city of Deir ez-Zor, the US-backed Syrian Democratic Forces are closing in on IS positions. This area is one of the last remaining strongholds the militants have left in Syria. and IS are desperately fighting to keep it.
They're attacking our positions here in the village. Now we're being targeted by snipers.
The men quickly return fire. For these men, it's personal. Many have had family members killed by IS. In another nearby village, these fighters no longer face the threat of IS. The militants have been pushed out, replaced by Syrian government forces.
Our defensive line is over there, at the sugar factory. Beyond that, the regime is in control. IS is no longer present there. We had an agreement that we will not target each other, but we have been shelled by artillery fire.
The war here has drawn in the world's biggest players, and now their proxies face each other. In this area, these US-backed forces now line up against Syrian regime troops, who in turn are supported by Russia. The stakes here are high. The big question is, what will happen next? Firas Kilani, BBC News, Deir Zor.
So, looks like Syria is gaining some ground on ISIS, man. It looks like they pushing them the fuck out the damn way, which is a good thing because, you know, Syria is protected by Russia. So, you know, yeah. Back not too long ago, they actually had a chemical attack on their natives and whatnot. And, of course, Trump did what he does and authorized the missile attack because they fucked up a whole damn city, man, which was really fucked up, really sad. I mean, babies were fucking hit, you know, kids were damn dying and stuff. This chemical attack was really fucked up. It attacked your lungs and your nervous system. So, yep. It's like a nerve agent. And Russia didn't like that too much that we bombed them, but, you know, if you're protecting Syria, and the only reason why they're doing that is because of the oil and stuff over there. And that's been clearly fucking plain put out there that it's because of the oil. And, which, okay, cool, I get it, because Russia don't have a backup reserve like we do. You know, that's one of the key things that plays into this whole World War III that, BBC keeps bringing up. Because they think Korea, North Korea, if World War III is to start, North Korea is going to start it. Which, you know, over this past weekend, man, it's stuff that I've kind of kept up with. Yeah, I watch a lot of BBC news because they're kind of like the neutral news party. You know, they're not Fox, they're not CNN to where it's fake news. This is like really put out. And China is like pulling away from North Korea, which is a good thing. Because China and Russia are in alliance with each other. And if China pulls away from North Korea, then Russia's going to pull away. Because they have no interest. And which is pretty badass. That puts a lot of favor back towards us. And North Korea is just fucking left. You know, the Chinese government does not like the fact that, you know, North Korea is literally trying to plot a fucking stupid-ass attack against us. And it's not really our borders, but if they start bombing, you know, they said Seoul, South Korea would be one of the main targets. And if they do that, then they're going to hit innocent Americans. And that's not going to leave Trump any choice but to go ahead and say, all right, fuckers, it's on. Yeah, he'll activate all our forces in Japan. The Marines will be activated. The Navy will be activated. It's going to take 3 to 4 days to load everything up on the ships and start heading out there. And wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. It's on like Donkey Kong. Yep. Yes, China is pulling troops on their borders. You got that little kind of neutral zone between North Korea and South Korea. But China's pulling shit too. So it's being known. Hopefully the Rocket Man, I doubt he gets any sense.
Yeah, I think that's where he's gotten a lot of his mindset's like, well, you know, I got China backing, you know, I got Russia backing, you know, in a certain aspect of it. And I think that's where he's gotten a lot of his fortitude from, in a sense. Uh-huh. He doesn't feel like, you know, he's got that backing from those two countries. So he's thinking, okay, I'm good. I can, you know, throw my little tirade, but Now they're backing out. I think he's rethinking some things here and there because he won't have the troop size that he thinks he has.
Right. All right. I agree 100%. Dog Tag Dave says the Moab problem solved.
Yeah.
I agree dropping the Moab, but I don't think it's going to solve everything right off the bat. I think it's going to be call for a lot more a lot more discussion, a lot more talk and whatnot. You know, it's, we got to make sure China is not going to, you know, try to pull any shit if North Korea decided to really throw this shit out there. You know,
yeah.
Their nuclear strike cannot reach our borders, cannot reach the West Coast, because they're going to have to attack the West Coast. That's the closest to them. You know, if Russia got involved, then Alaska's kind of fucked. You know, it's just, you know, they're a lot closer than what people think. People think they're way, way, way the fuck over there. Not really. If you go to the West Coast and you look at the map, the Pacific Ocean is bigger, but when you go up north, we're a lot fucking closer than what people think. I mean, Alaska and Russia is not that far apart. So
I think it's just a few miles that separates them.
Yeah, something like that. Something like that.
It's not a whole lot.
Mm-mm. You know, but there we kind of got Canada's backing on that part too, which Canada is pretty much, you know, I'm surprised Canada hasn't become a part of the U.S. I'm actually surprised that never happened, but there's really not much up there either, but a bunch of fucking cold weather, fucking a lot, shit ton of snow, fuck all that, you can have it. You can have it.
Yeah.
But, all right. Yeah. Fucking rocking, dude. That's, that is fucking killer. So, you know, that's good. You know, and that's, yeah, I kind of wonder, though, too, in the same sense, with all this bullshit that's happening stateside, you know, what has ISIS really been up to? And BBC kind of keeps up with that. So, that's pretty cool. Pretty nice to see that they're dwindling away. All right. Let's go into a little song break. Here's Social Distortion, Ring of Fire.
Burns, burns.